Jessica and I both have given you a lot of paper to look over. I'm just going to give you just a little bit of a summary about the first one, which is the piece I'm going to talk briefly about, which is this one, about the APR. This is something that we couldn't be happier about. Just to say it right off the bat, we have gotten ourselves out of provisionally accredited and become fully accredited for the first time in I don't know how many years. We, as a school district, the entire district is fully accredited. We jumped from our APR points, which is our annual performance points, and in this in this piece that I've given you, it lays out and describes a lot of the ways, the way those points, that 140 points total that you see on that first page, those are the total points possible, spread out over academic achievement, subgroup achievement, college and career ready, attendance, and graduation rates. I've given you where I can, and that's why it's a little bit thick. I've given you a three-year breakdown of that, so you can back go up as you go through it. You'll start seeing 15, 14, 13 for the whole district. You'll see 15, 14, 13 for the each building, for the elementary, and then again for the high school. And then towards the end, you'll see it broken down by standard. And that gets a little bit harder to read. There's a lot of scoring-ish situations back on that very back page with supporting data. Some of it I don't expect you to know, but it really gives you an idea of how some of the numbers are arrived at. I touched on it briefly. If you notice in our college career ready, our attendance, and our and our graduation rate, I believe it was. We gained points primarily in college and career ready and our attendance rate. And that's from a lot of effort from a lot of people in the building, but it's a particular effort by Ms. Clemens and Ms. McWhorter. They weren't satisfied with the numbers that were showing up in our, and so I got some help in here from Sedalia School 200, their lady that works with them. So she came down and helped Jessica and Barb, and we really went back and did a fine comb, and it was the last time we could go back and redo those numbers. They went through our data in regard to that, in all of our data, all of our numbers, and we found some things that we had just mismarked. So a lot of that point jump comes from those two areas, and we're very happy with that. When you do that mid-cycle, it doesn't show up. Some of those numbers and points were probably there for the last in 2014, but since they don't do it again until now, when it comes back around at this time, it didn't show up until now. So probably that we jumped from, our APR jumped from 92.5 points out of 140 up to 112.5 out of 140. It was probably the biggest one school jump in the state of Missouri for APR points. And it slammed us up into fully accredited. I'm very happy about that. It's just a credit to what we're doing and what we're trying to do. You'll notice as you look down through there, our academic and subgroup achievements, that's always the one that's the struggle to get the most points on. You'll notice that we had some highs in some areas and some lows in some other areas. Elementary's still working hard to gain some ground. High school picked up a little bit of the slack for us, so we didn't lose in total APR points. We're aware of those areas, and Jessica's going to talk in just a second about some more of those a little bit more. But we are all zoned in, and really what this has done is really helped us paint a picture of what we need to work on next, maintain what we've gained, and what we need to work on next. So I've asked Jessica to put some sheets, her charts and stuff are a lot fancier than mine.
Well, they are.
They're a lot more descriptive, maybe. I don't know. Mine's pretty dry. It's pretty dry numbers. But I just wanted to say before she takes over the floor about talking about some academic achievement that I can't say enough about the staff who, they may not know exactly what each one of these numbers mean. They know what it means in their area. But it is a very good and comforting feeling as a leader to look at that and see people taking the initiative to figure out ways to make that number come up for us. And it's making it come up for us, and I'm happy about that. So
I need to, just for, on behalf of the board, you know, this is really awesome. And I'm sure each and everybody says that, and my hat's off to all everybody that was involved, Terry, Becky, Jessica, Deb, whoever, all the teachers and everybody, this is really nice to see from our standpoint, so, awesome job.
Thank you.
And we're going to put this out in the paper, we're getting a press release, I was hoping that we might, we'll get it put out there, and we're gonna work together here for the next week, and sometime between, maybe not before the holidays, before we get out of here, but we're gonna get a press release put together about this, and try to be descriptive about what that means to us, and what that means to the school, and just how big of a, nice of a step that is.
Yeah, and we're definitely going in the right direction, you can see it, it's on paper, everything's right here, and it's all color-coded for us.
I like color codes, yeah. So before we kind of get into it, and I go through the charts with you, I want to explain a little bit about the testing, because if it's not an adventure that you've had, it's just kind of foreign, so hopefully we'll all leave here a little more educated about it. In terms of the MAP testing, that is for grades 3 through 8, and there was a new format this year. It was online, it was with the computers. We've never done that before. Our kids were very nervous. Our teachers were very nervous. The state kept pushing the details and the dates around. They would tell us that it was going to be one way, and then they would take that back and change their mind. But in my conversations with other area testing coordinators, our kids fared better than other area kids. They were more prepared whenever they got into the lab. Mrs. Reeder was our librarian last year. She did a great job of preparing our kids with different games. So they got in and they knew how to use the games. They had typing skills at third grade. They were just able to manipulate the test in ways that other area students were not. So we were very proud of that. Another issue that our elementary kids faced was the timing of it was flawed. The MAP tests are not timed whenever they're computerized, but DESE provides timing guidelines that we can use for scheduling. And so, one area, for example, the English Language Arts test for grades 3 through 8, every grade level took that test. It was two different sections. We put it together because they said, hey, that's fine. The two sections will take less than 2 hours. So we thought, okay, we'll take a test, we'll take a break, we'll take the other part of the test. Our kids average 3.5 hours. On that test. So whenever you think that this is a brand new test, a brand new format, they're already thinking that they're going to settle in for a 2-hour test and ends up being almost 4. That was a challenge. But they buckled down, they did a really good job. And so the other side of that is that DESE's saying that they're only going to tweak the test a little bit this year, that they're going to take care of some of those timing issues, they're going to fix the length so that it is more appropriate for those grade levels. And so our kids and our teachers should be better prepared. They've seen it once, they have an idea of what to expect, and so we're happy about that. In terms of high school tests for end of course, that format's been the same since 2011, and that's why we've seen more consistency with our high school scores. And we've had areas that have been up. English language arts has always been a strength of ours. We've had areas that have been down. Social studies has been a struggle. We are making changes to address those. And so we've had some interventions that have been very successful in English language arts. We are following suit in the areas of social studies and math in the high school areas to try to gain some of that success in those areas as well. In your charts, I have color-coded the results by area and grade level. So the bold boxes represent groups as a whole, and other boxes represent grade levels within that subject area. So just looking through my notes, making sure I'm covering everything that I wanted to tell you. Just a little bit more about the MAP test is that grades 5 through 8, in addition to testing in English language arts and math, tested in science as well. Those 5th and 8th graders got it extra hard because then they also had to have classroom performance events in English language arts and science. This was something that none of us had ever seen before. It consisted of a classroom lesson and discussion followed by test-related questions. So those 5th and 8th graders got hit hard and often. For in a course testing, there were performance events conducted in the areas of biology, algebra 1, and English 2. And that usually consists of some kind of a reading, and then you have to do some kind of a graphing activity, usually demonstrating your knowledge and how well you understand those concepts. And then there were last minute changes that we had to deal with as well. As a state requirement, there are 4 in a course exams required for graduation from any Missouri high school, and those are Algebra 1, Biology, English 2, and Government. In previous years, districts could receive bonus points toward our APR scores if we took any of those extra tests. And those extra tests were Algebra 2, Geometry, American History, and English 1. So we've always taken all of the in-course exams. But then DESE announced that the non-required test scores would have zero impact or effect on our district's APR scores. And we decided to go ahead and proceed with the tests like we had planned for several reasons. One of the reasons was that some students need to take that Algebra 2 and or Geometry in order to be A-plus certified. We also wanted to evaluate and compare student performance after changing our social studies sequence. So if you recall, last year we switched things to reflect the traditional Missouri sequence of social studies classes. So now our freshmen take American History and our juniors take government. It was flip-flopped. We thought that maturity-wise, that was a better fit. That's also what more high schools do. So we wanted to be able to gauge that. And then we'd already been prepping kids to test in those areas, and we wanted to stay there.